Praise the King! Welcome to Believers Central World Update on Christians United Broadcasting Network. How's everybody doing today? You know, it was funny. Somebody wrote on my Facebook wall that that watching me do the shout-outs to my chat room was like watching Romper Room. But you know what? The scripture says if you don't think like children, that you can't enter the kingdom of heaven. So welcome to Believer Central World Romper Room. I love you guys. How you doing? There's Michelle and Clinet and Chrissy and Janine and Jonathan and Wonder Woman and Shanna. And wow, there's all my buddies and Melanie. Hi, guys. Wow, there's Michelle. I see all of you. Hi. Well, serious business today, okay? Hi, Shanna. Serious business. Loved ones, yeah. I did a nutshell on Ezekiel 38 that we uploaded on our YouTube channel at Believers Central One. Wow. We need to talk about what's going on over there in Israel, okay? This is serious business. Now, we've identified with Ezekiel 38, we have identified some of the characters who are clearly involved in this war where in Ezekiel 38. And there was something that just did not grab my attention like it needed to in that Ezekiel 38 study. Okay? Let's go over there. And I'm going to point out to you something that God did not really emphasize to me when I was studying it, but now he is. And Ezekiel chapter 38. Wait, let's pray first and let's ask the Lord for understanding, okay? Father, in the name of Jesus, we bow before you, come before your throne, O Lord, asking that permission to sit at your feet and learn from you, mighty King of heaven. We give you praise and honor and glory, Lord. You are our heart. You are our true love. And we honor you, my King. Plant the seed of your word in good soil in our hearts, I pray, that it may bear fruit abundant for you. In Jesus' name, grant us the spirit of understanding that's before your throne, my King, and cause us to understand, or we will not. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, yes. Let's look at this. There was a reference to Libya and Ethiopia. And that is where I want to focus. Well, for those of you, I realize that not all of you have seen the nutshell. Gog is the predominant driving spirit in Ezekiel 38. And I'm not going to make you wait through this whole lesson for what I have to say. Okay, I'm just going to tell you right off the bat here. This war could be, it is shaping up, it's looking like a duck, it's quacking like a duck, it's washing, you know. No, Russia isn't Gog. Gog is a spirit. And we know this because Gog shows up again. Okay, Gog shows up again in Revelation chapter 20, verse 8. If you want to slide over there, we'll read that. It says, Revelation 20, verse 8, and shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sand of the sea. This timing of this verse is after the millennium. This is after the 1,000-year millennium where Jesus is here on the throne. We still have Gog and Magog. That's how we know. Oh, and that, one of the reasons. It's a confirmation, if you will. I can show you many other reasons why we know. But that is one confirmation that tells us that this is a spirit. This is not a man. This is not a country. This is a spirit of anti-Semitism and injustice. We outlined that, Gog has to be an evil spirit because it shows up again. God sends it again. The verse 7 says, and when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison and shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog. Now, that is the spirit of anti-Semitism. See, that spirit is going to prevail again at the end of the millennium. See, that spirit is the main one that is involved here because it is the hatred of God's people. Okay? And when you have the hatred of God's people, you have the spirit of Gog. So everywhere, it's everywhere, okay? But it does say that it concentrates. See, spirits are territorial, okay? The spirit of Gog concentrates in the area of Magog, which is Iran, Afghanistan, and Pakistan, okay? Now, that is where the spirit of Gog, which is the destruction of Israel, anti-Semitism, wanting to blow Israel off the map, that is coming straight out of Gog's mouth, the spirit, through Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, the president and crazy little dictator in Iran. Don't worry, they can't see my show in Iran. They see it in all the surrounding. They see it in the Middle East, but not in Iran and not in China, okay? They do see it in Syria, Jordan, Lebanon, Israel, Gaza, Egypt, Tanzania, Tunisia, Libya, Algeria, Ethiopia, Sudan. They do see my show throughout the Middle East and Northern Africa. That's why I get so many death threats. These Muslims, they just don't like me much. But you know what? I love them, and I'm going to continue to tell them the truth. And Jesus died for them. They are children of Abraham. It's important to reach out to them because you know what? They bless their hearts. They are born into that captivity. And you know what? It's not like it is here in America for them. To accept Christ as their Savior, they have to give their lives. A lot of them, they do, because their own families will kill them. Their own friends and neighbors will kill them for converting to Christianity and away from the evils of Islam. So, you know, pray for them. They pay a very high price once the Spirit reaches them with the truth. And they, you know, just today, did you know that just today, a man, a precious Arab man who was raised in Islam like all the rest of them over there, he found the Lord Jesus Christ and converted away from Islam to Christianity. And just today, he was beheaded for his faith in Somalia. His head was cut off today. Today. So all you people that think, you know, oh, well, we haven't suffered. We got to hang out through the tribulation period. Well, you know what? Get over it. There's people being beheaded for their faith in Jesus Christ today. Today, right now. And, you know, there's nothing that says it's only going to be during the trib. There are believers giving their heads right now today. And this precious believer in Somalia was beheaded this morning, and I bet you he's not the only one. Okay? I mean, it is, you know, anyway, what I'm trying to say here is that Gog is a spirit of anti-Semitism. The Magog is the Iran, Afghanistan, Pakistan, this radical Muslim area. You've got, well, let's go back to Ezekiel 38. Because I was, you know, my conclusion to the study that we did in the nutshell was that it's not time for this northern army to come down against Israel yet. Let's talk about that a little bit. One of the reasons I think it's not time, okay? Syria is markedly absent from this scenario. Syria isn't around when this occurs, is what that tells me. Syria is nowhere to be found. Everybody else is. All the rest of those players are there. Syria is nowhere to be found. So where is Syria? You think Syria suddenly decides they like Israel? I don't think so. I think that we might be closer than I have previously anticipated, although I hesitate to deviate at all from what I have said previously, in that the tetrads do indicate these wars between spring and fall of 2014. Okay? Now, here's something I want you to consider, if you would. In verse 5 of Ezekiel 38, we have Persia. You know what Persia is? That's Iran. We have Ethiopia. Now, Ethiopia is not involved in this conflict yet. Okay? We don't have Ethiopia involved here. So, it's not quite time yet. It's not going to be blown up in anybody's face tomorrow. Notice in verse 5 also, Libya. Now, Libya can kind of qualify as being engaged partially, because all the weapons that are flooding through Egypt into the Gaza Strip are coming from Libya. And they're not just those little punky rockets that those guys seem to cannot be able to aim worth anything. Well, you know, God is protecting Israel. That's why they can't hit anything. You know, they'll hit something every now and then, but, you know, very rarely, which is why, one of the reasons why the world community is not paying any attention at all to the fact that Israel's being bombarded by rockets. And that a million people in Israel are in their shelters right now as we speak. They're not considering at all, you know, that if Hamas would stop firing at Israel, that Israel would stop firing into the Gaza Strip. All they want to focus on is all the damage that Israel's doing. Oh, they're killing children. They're targeting journalists. All this. Well, let me tell you something. You cowards in Palestine, in the Gaza Strip, you're a bunch of cowards if you hide behind children and fire your missiles from the tops of schools and hospitals, and hide behind journalists. You put all the foreign journalists in the TV station that broadcasts for Hamas. Hiding behind them all is human shields. Hiding behind babies like human shields. You're a bunch of cowards. Sorry. But you know what? I'm not sorry. You are. You're a bunch of cowards if you hide behind children. If you can't take the heat, quit firing the rockets. You know, you're going to fire rockets and then stand behind little children? Funk. Okay? Don't even talk to me about, you know, the damage Israel's doing while you're firing at them and then hiding behind children. Because you know for a fact that when Israel fires back on your position that you just fired on them for, then all those children will die and you don't care about those children. You don't care about them at all. All you care about is you want them to die, so it gives Israel bad press. Shame, shame. Okay. Yeah, that is just gutless, cowardly. It just makes me nauseous. Now, Libya could possibly... Thank you for the little smiley face that's puking. I appreciate that. That's my sentiment. I love you too, Shanna. Thank you, Wonder Woman, for the little pukey smiley. Yeah, that's what I'm... What kind of person takes a pot shot at somebody who's stronger than them and then hides behind a little kid when they know they're going to get shot back at? Yes, cowards. Cowards. Okay. Hiding behind women and children and foreign journalists. Get a clue. Have some personal respect for yourself and some honor. If you can't stand out there and take the shots back at you, quit firing at them. Okay. Persia, Ethiopia, Libya. With them, all of them with shield and helmet. These are army. Okay? Now, right now, we have Turkey and NATO are concentrated in Russia and kind of Iran. You know, everybody's kind of got some distractions going on here with Syria. Now, we know that Syria is going to go up in smoke. We know Syria is going up in a mushroom cloud. One of either two ways. Now, either a nuclear weapon explodes in Damascus or some kind of asteroid falls out of the sky right on Damascus and totally obliterates it. Okay? Overnight. And I think, let's toss over to Isaiah 17 real quick. Go backwards in your Bible. Isaiah 17. Okay. Now remember, Isaiah is between the Song of Solomon and Jeremiah. Let's go over to Isaiah 17. Now this is where Damascus is toast. Okay? The crushing of Damascus. Verse 1 says, "The burden of Damascus. Behold, Damascus is taken away from being a city, and it shall be a ruinous heap." Now, the rest of this scripture has details. But look at verse 14, the last one in that chapter of Isaiah 17. "And behold, at evening tide, trouble." Okay, now what does that mean? "Behold, at evening tide, trouble. And before the morning, he is not." So, at evening tide in Israel, I'll tell you what I imagine happening, what I envision happening from the scriptures when I read them. Okay? What it seems like is happening to me here is that at evening tide, that's it, that would be Israel time. Everything is Israel time in the Bible, okay? Evening tide, trouble. Now, I think probably what happened is that Assad is backed into a corner and has a situation where he thinks he's going down. And he is. It's just a matter of time. And he has been more difficult for them to take down than they thought he would be. He's hung in there for 2 years. Did you know that? Okay. No, Damascus isn't already a pile of ashes. You'll know about it, Christopher. Hi, by the way. Yeah, you'll know about it. It's not already gone. Hello, Sheila. Hi, sweetie. It's not a pile of ashes yet. I'll tell you what I think probably happens. And that is that before Assad goes down, on his way down. See, it's Arabs that are trying to take him down. And Persians. Not from Iran, but he's got the Turks trying to take him down. The old Ottoman Empire trying to be revived. Well, he's fighting the Muslim Brotherhood and Al-Qaeda, I'm not going to go there. All right, I started to say who we happen to be. You know, we're fighting in one place and funding them in another place. Go figure. What I think happens is that Assad is going to fire up one of his nukes. And Israel has technology, see, where they can tell, they can read a nuclear signature when it's on its way to countdown. And they have the technology to blow the thing up right in Assad's face. Once they know it's been turned on, they can send a signal that will blow the thing up right in his face. And I think they've done that with bombs before, you know. But anyway, that's why these Arabs that are trying to blow up Israel and building these bombs and everything, you know, remarkably often, their bombs blow up in their own faces. And I think that's why, because Israel has technology and they can read the signatures when these bombs are on their way to countdown, you know, or when these bombs are activated and are counting down to be launched. And they can blow them up right there where they sit, right in the person's face. It's amazing. But, I think that's entirely possible. Because once, with Syria gone, okay, then let's roll right back over to Ezekiel. Let's roll back over to Ezekiel 38. Okay, now you got Gog, the land of Magog. That's the spirit. We talked about that. Okay. Magog is the place, Iran, Afghanistan, Pakistan. Gog is the spirit of anti-Semitism. You've got, he's the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal. And our studies revealed that Meshach and Tubal were merchants. They were human traffickers and weapon makers. Mm-hmm. That's who we're looking at with Meshach and Tubal. It's not a location. It's weapons manufacturers and human trafficking. Slaves. Now, the Lord says he's going to force them down. It's Gog that he uses to do that. The spirit of anti-Semitism. They hate Israel so bad that they're rabid. I mean, they will sacrifice their children. They'll blow themselves up. And what they don't even have a clue of is that they are the invaders, not Israel. Israel's got a 5,000-year history or more in that area of the world. Actually, closer to 6,000-year history. And the Arabs don't. Okay, now they went up further, and you know, there's millions and millions of square miles of Arab land, and Israel has this tiny little strip that's like 9 miles wide in its narrowest spot, but they just can't live with Israel existing at all, okay? It's like an in-your-face thing to them, because they see Israel prosper. The desert has just turned into a beautiful oasis for them, but it didn't do it for the Arabs. Gaza used to be a paradise. Then Israel handed it over to the Palestinians, to the PA, and look what happened. Hamas took over. In less than 2 years after Israel handed it over, it was a complete wasteland again. The land will refuse to produce for anyone except for the Jews. God has commanded the land to produce only for them. So the minute, you know, what they don't understand, they want this beautiful pearl of great price, which is Israel, which, you know, Israel is so fertile and productive that they are the world's top producer of fruit and flowers. Did you know that? That tiny little country. The desert has just bloomed under their care. And it's because it was commanded to do so by God. And that just hacks those Palestinians off so bad. All the Arabs, really. Because it's a desert wasteland for them, where they're at. Okay? No matter where they live in it, it's a desert wasteland for them. It doesn't do a thing for them. It's a constant struggle. The land will not produce for them. But there's a loophole. If any of you precious Arab people out there actually want to get a clue and walk in some blessings, here's how you do it. I'll tell you when we get back. We're going to a break. Stay tuned.
You just want to dream again and believe. Yeah. Your sky is dim and gray. But know your breakthrough's not far away. That's what we want you to do.
So hold on.
Yes.
You are too close to give up.
You have so much to live for.
You have so much to live for.
Remember what you pray for. Give up.
Please don't let go in this season. Know that flowers bloom when rain falls.
So no matter what you're going through right now,
you just hold on.
Come on, Monica.
You ask, will this go away? Know that God can feel your pain. Never fall short of His way. Sometimes we forget that He holds us in His hands. But I'm reminding you, don't give up.
Yeah.
Sometimes your skies may seem dark and gray.
We all have days like that.
Just know your breakthrough's not far.
Listen,
you just hold on.
I'm speaking from experience. I was there. Because it's just about over. But here's the good news. Listen.
Yes, say ah, yes,
are
say
ah. Are coming to pass.
Whoa, whoa.
So I'm telling you, don't lose your faith.
Don't lose
Hold
your faith.
Hold on to His word.
Don't give up.
Come on, friend.
Sometimes your skies may seem dim and gray. I know your breakthrough's not far away.
Because
you are so close to
you're close to it.
As a little boy, I used to dream of the big stage.
I gotta tell you, that was just terrible. That music was awful. What was that? I heard that and I thought, oh my gosh, what's dying? Sounded like a cat dying or something. What was that, CBN radio? That's not CUBN, that's CBN, okay? That is not our network's music. We play cool stuff. We do. We play the good stuff. But that was just really terrible, and I apologize that you had to sit through that, because I heard that out of the corner of my ear, and I was thinking, oh, that's awful. What is that? Maybe it was just my sound, but ooh. Okay. All right, now, first thing I want to do is make sure I don't leave you hanging on where we left off, okay? Precious Arab people, I'm going to tell you how to get blessed, okay? If you want blessings like you see Israel have, here's how you do it. You drop your hatred for Israel, and you bless them. And you turn back away from Allah, who's the ancient Babylonian moon god, to your God, the God of your father Ishmael, the God of Abraham. See, Allah is not the God of Abraham. Go back further before Muhammad. Go back to the God of Abraham, who has told Israel, whoever blesses you, I will bless. Whoever curses you, I will curse. Now, if you change your tune and you start taking up for Israel and standing for Israel instead of against Israel, you will find that the land will bloom for you as well. Okay? If you bless Israel, you're going to get blessed like Israel. If you curse Israel, you're going to get cursed, and that is no fun. So I know that you guys struggle, and I know that you feel like you were the firstborn and have the birthright. But you know what? The birthright isn't always given to the firstborn. We saw that with the sons of Jacob. Reuben was the firstborn, but Reuben didn't inherit the blessing, did he? No. The firstborn did not inherit the blessing. Many times. Just like Esau and Jacob. Esau was firstborn, but Jacob ended up with the blessing. Reuben was firstborn, and Joseph ended up with the blessing. And the blessing and the genealogy didn't necessarily go hand in hand, because the Messiah didn't come from the line of Joseph. He came from the line of Judah. Okay? He's the lion of the tribe of Judah. So, it does, you know, the way God does it, oh, that is just a really low blow, Cuban. You know what he did? He stuck a really yummy looking chocolate chip cookie. Oh, he's got more. Oh, it's torture. Okay. I'm going to have to concentrate on what I'm doing, but I'm prepared for you. Okay. I am prepared for you. Look what I got. All right. Now, this is a pretty serious lesson. So I came armed. Now, I have M&Ms. Ooh, I've only got one red one. I think it was Sherry that said she liked the red one. Now, I like the green ones. Okay. Oh, and the yellow ones. Oh, that package had a whole bunch of yellow ones and green ones. It's my lucky day. Okay. And that wasn't quite enough, so I had to go for the big guns, which is the Orange Crush. See? This isn't a commercial for M&M's and Orange Crush. I just like them, okay? I'm looking for joy everywhere I can get it. And, you know, I do love the chocolate chip cookies, but they have to be homemade, you know what I mean, for me to like them. I don't like the canned, you know, manufactured by the millions cookies. Not real well, except for the famous Amos ones. Those are pretty good, but I'm not really into the manufactured cookie. It's the ones that come out of the oven. Okay. Yeah, Janine and Melanie are onto it. The ones that come out of the oven. My 14-year-old daughter makes the best chocolate chip cookies on the planet. All right. She's great. She really is. All right, let's get back into our study here. What I'm getting at, you guys, is that this looks like it's starting to shape up into what we expect from Ezekiel 38, but we're waiting on Ethiopia. We haven't seen Ethiopia involved yet. Now, that's entirely possible, though. Okay, Ethiopia is a mess. So is the Sudan. Ethiopia and the Sudan are a mess. Now, the Sudan, we know, they're upset and they're kind of involved because Israel went and blew up their missile plant and, oh, they were so upset. Wah, 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 wah. Israel blew up our missile plant. Somebody go get them. You know, the Sudan, they're trying to build missiles for Iran, so they're mad at Israel too. But they're not massing troops. Now, this is talking about troops, because if you'll notice in verse 5, all of them with shield and helmet. They're in uniform. These are armies. Okay? Ah. Oh, that's so good. Okay. You got to find joy anywhere you can get it. Okay? You know what I'm saying? Yellow M&Ms. Yum. Okay. Now, we're waiting on Ethiopia to get involved, although we do see Sudan already attempting to somewhat engage in this battle. We have Libya, who is not engaged with forces like this says they will be. Right now, Libya's involvement is limited to smuggling weapons through Egypt. Well, they don't really have to smuggle them through Egypt. Egypt is allowing it. Mohamed Morsi or whatever his name is over there, and the president of Egypt now, the Muslim Brotherhood guy, he is trying to get out of the treaty with Israel. You've had two missiles now fired from Egypt into Israel, although that front seems to be quiet at the moment. You've got all heck breaking loose in Gaza, where Israel is going in there and mopping up. Way to go, IDF and IAF. That's the Israel Defense Forces and the Israeli Air Force. Rock on. They are the probably, you know, it's like David and Goliath, except this time David's going to get his tail kicked. Okay? David is going to get stomped this time and by Israel. You don't mess with Israel, okay? The Bible is really clear about that. Look at their blessings. Look at what their God does for them and decide to try their God on for size instead of your one that doesn't do nothing for you, okay? That's seriously my recommendation. A buckler, I looked that up one time. It has something to do with your uniform. It, like, holds your uniform all, I don't know. It has something to do with your uniform, but I don't remember exactly what it was. I should look it up again, I guess, huh? Okay, but here's my point, which I keep trying to get back to. This war that we see happening, this Gaza thing. Now, it's possible that it might not turn into this war. It could be just another one of those skirmishes where Israel, kind of like cast lead, where Israel has to go in and clean house over there in Gaza. They've had 1,000 missiles fired at them in Israel, including in their populated areas. Also, that you've got 1 million Israelis in their shelters right now instead of being at work and at school and and all the things that normal life affords. They're in their shelters, okay? Because they're being fired at. Israel is going in there and really they're doing a job. Now, see, keep in mind, I still believe that we're not looking at these wars flaring up to be the seal judgment wars until between spring and fall of 2014. I'll tell you why, because even if you've got these guys about to fully engage, the rapture is expected next. Now, the rapture of the believers is going to bring a screeching halt to these wars. Okay? It's going to bring a screeching halt to them, even if they're just about to blow up any second, because all of a sudden, everybody's children is gone. Everybody's grandchildren. Every soldier out there, their children and grandchildren are gone. Little brothers and sisters, whatever. You know, the children are gone. And that's just going to stun the world to where it puts a pause on these wars long enough to buy a little bit more time. It's just not time yet. I do think that the tetrads mean something. They have in the past. I mean, it doesn't mean that they will continue to do so. But I think since they've been consistent the previous two times that they've appeared within this prophetic generation, that they, it's a possibility. You know, I think it's a possibility. You're killing me, Cuban. What are you doing? Oh, you kill me. He's going to crack me up the whole show. Well, that's good. We need to laugh, you know, because these are very sobering times. And we've got a lot of serious stuff going on. Now, let's keep going here. So, remember, we don't have Ethiopia engaged yet in this battle. Persia has not come down against them yet. Plus, Syria is nowhere to be found in this scenario, and Syria is still around right now. So, we're going to have the destruction of Damascus prior to this war of Ezekiel 38. Now, what I think personally is that this Israeli thing into Gaza is going to be kind of like they did in Operation Cast Lead. They go in there, they clean house, and then they pull back out again, and Hamas is, you know, castrated enough to where they can't do anything for a while. So, now, Clinton wants to know who Gomer is. Gomer is Turkey. Yes. Gomer is Turkey. And you've got, now Tagarma is Russia. And it's not because of the location of Tagarma. It's because of its spiritual identification. Tagarma is, well, let me read you the scripture. Let me get you the scripture. You can see for yourself. Tagarma is, they are merchants of manpower, vehicles, transportation. Okay? And that's what their characteristic is. Oh my God. Now, if you start looking at who is supplying all of the hardware, vehicles, transportation, and soldiers, then you're going to look toward Russia. It's going to take you right back to Russia. Let's look at that scripture real quick here. Okay, in Ezekiel 38:6. It says, Gomer and all his bands, the house of Tagarma of the north quarters and all his bands and many people with thee. Now, Ezekiel 27:4 tells us about the house of Tagarma. It says in 27:14, they of the house of Tagarma traded in thy fairs with horses and horsemen and mules. That is soldiers, vehicles, tanks. Okay? Now, where's all this? Where's all the hardware coming from? Where are all these soldiers in red coming from? Because they have breastplates of kind of a brimstone color. Okay? That's Russia. All right, here we go. You've got Tagarma supplies transportation methods, soldiers, and other military equipment. So that's Tagarma right there. Because, you know, the actual physical location of Tagarma is somewhere, you know, around Afghanistan or whatever. And you know what? Afghanistan is not going to supply these wars with soldiers and with vehicles and all this armory. It's not going to happen. Okay? Russia is the only one that has that kind of stuff to supply them in masses, you know, massive numbers. So we've got Tagarma is Russia. So Russia is involved. Okay? It's just, I know a lot of teachers in the past have thought Russia was Gog. But Russia is not Gog. They are Tagarma, if you look through the spirit. You have to look up these names and find out the characteristics of the spirit it's talking about here, and it'll point you straight to the nation that it's talking about. Now, so we know right now that it can't blow up like today or tomorrow. This Gaza war, I think, will probably just turn out to be you know, another like Operation Cast Lead. It's been going on for 6 days now, but they estimate it'll go on for about 7 weeks. Okay? Now, yeah, it's possible that it could escalate between now and then. It's possible it won't. You know, it could be over in 2 days if Hamas gets hurt enough to where they stop firing rockets. Israel is lowering the boom on them. They've done, what, hundreds and hundreds of sorties, you know, going in there and bombing. They're bombing tunnels, they're bombing weapons, they're bombing missile stores, they're bombing leaders of Hamas, they're bombing the Hamas television station. They bombed the Hamas's headquarters. I mean, every rocket launcher they can see, they're taking it out. You know, and unfortunately, Hamas is a bunch of cowards. They put their rocket launchers on top of schools and hospitals and hotels where foreign journalists are. They want all these deaths of innocents because that's what they're going to use against Israel. Orange M&M, Orange Crush. Orange Overload. Wonderful. Okay. Now, so these wars here. Now, this one's called Pillar of Cloud. Now, that one's interesting, and it may turn out to be something different. Because remember the Pillar of Cloud from the Book of Exodus that led the children of Israel by day? Well, it wasn't a pillar of cloud by night, though, was it? It was a dual thing. At night, it was pillar of fire. Okay? Now, when Israel goes and uses these Bible references, I love it when they do that. Now, see, cast lead, that's not a Bible reference. And it didn't turn out to be anything either, did it? This one hasn't so far. It looks exactly like cast lead did, but it has possibilities. And as long as Egypt is resisting the, you know, wanting to smooth over peaceful relations with Israel, we're going to continue to have this scenario looming between now and then. Now, Egypt could put a stop to it by reinforcing the treaty. And by cutting off all these illegal weapons into Gaza, that could stop it. And that might be possible. Now, here's the thing. Obama has a heck of a lot of pull with Morsi, okay? Because Obama is like, you know, they're Muslim. They just love the guy. They love Obama. They want to make him their caliph, of their Muslim king. It's horrible. But when the rapture occurs, these wars are going to be put on hold. And I really do think that they will show up, you know, between spring and fall of 2014. In the meantime, see, we've got other events that have to happen before this can happen. The rapture of the believers has to happen. Okay? Now, not just the rapture of the believers. Now, remember, the rapture of the believers is going to be a trigger for the triple whammy. Okay? The triple whammy is the rapture, which triggers the global economic meltdown, which triggers the fall of the sovereign government. So, all in one, you know, very short, it could be a couple days or even just as, you know, short as a week, people will lose their children, their money, their freedom, and their security. Whoosh, it's all gone instantly. And it's a whole new ball game. You got the Antichrist, as soon as the rapture occurs, if he's stepping in there. They're setting this up purposely. See, they know the rapture's coming too. They're looking forward to it just as much as we are. Okay? They can hardly wait to get us out of the way because we're the restrainer of evil. They can't do everything they want to the extent that they want with us still here. Okay? And they don't have authority with us still here. There's a lot they can do because we don't step up and stop them. But we are actually the authority here right now. Not them. Okay? Now, when the rapture occurs, it's going to stun the entire world. There is not a single country on the planet that's going to be immune from its effects when you have all the children taken. Now, I have people ask me, well, how do you know all of the children are going to be taken? Well, because for one, the kingdom of God belongs to the children. For two, they are unaccountable and therefore can't be left here. For three, they have to be taken, preserved as mortals, and returned as mortals to replenish and repopulate the earth within the 1,000-year millennium. Because we know at the end of the millennium, the earth is repopulated again, like it is now, okay? But you can't achieve that in 1,000 years without bringing all those children back, okay? So that's how we know. We're going alive, we're coming back alive. The Holy City has everything necessary to sustain world human life. And so, you know, don't worry. Don't worry that we die in this process. We don't. We don't die in this process. This is going to be really, really fun for us. And I would encourage you, if you have not given your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ, you should do that ASAP, because we're not even guaranteed to still be here long enough for me to finish this broadcast. Okay? We're looking at some really amazing prophetic events that are forming. And we can see that those from the north are, you know, I think what we're probably going to see turn into a real huge big deal first. And I don't know if we'll even be here to see this part, but I doubt that we will. But I think that, I think Damascus is going up first. And I'll tell you why. It's because Syria is not found in Ezekiel 38. We know they're one of Israel's enemies, don't we? They've been one of Israel's main nemesis, you know? They're an enemy of Israel, but they're not anywhere to be found here. So they have been destroyed already. Or they would be here, wouldn't they? They would be part of this group that's against Israel if they weren't already destroyed. So that gives us some some timing, okay? Or Ezekiel 38. I really do think we're going to have to see the destruction of Damascus first. And I'm thinking that we're not going to be here to see that. Because, see, the judgments, especially the seal judgments, these things already happen on the earth. You already have famines, you already have wars, you already have, you know, thousands and thousands and thousands of people dying from floods and quakes and all these different things, okay? Starvation, mostly. You already have people dying from those.
Innocently, hate is spreading rapidly. I'm not talking apathy, but some things God's gotta work. Whoa. He's gotta work. Yeah.
Okay, we're gonna go He's through gotta, right, guys. Whoa. Okay.
He's gotta work. Yeah. Check it out.
Everything
that is beautiful belongs to you, and we have
Hi, guys. Sorry, I'm trying to get CUBN to cut my break short because we've got a whole lot of information to go over. I haven't even told you what's going on in the news yet. Okay, we have got a lot of information to cover here, but I want to give you an idea where we are on God's timeline, okay? Now, keep in mind that we're looking at, I know this is going to be a lot of information, so you might take down some notes as I give this to you, and you can look all of this up, okay? Matthew 24, 32 through 34. This is where it tells us the Holocaust, the birth of the nation, and that generation would not pass away until all these things are fulfilled. Psalms 90:10 tells us that a lifetime generation is between 70 and 80 years since the time of King David. So now we have an 80-year at the longest generation to work with here on our timeline. So if you start, I did try to back this up. The Holocaust started in 1941, and I tried to back this up and see if we could go to 1921, but it's too late for that, okay? It's too late for that. It has to be 1948, the birth of the nation that started the prophetic clock and not the Holocaust, because I have checked that out now, okay? I've done the math on that, and it's too late for it to be that. There's not enough time for all the events to fit into the rest of the generation if you count from 1941. So it's got to be from 1948 at the birth of Israel. We've got Israel 64 years old right now, okay? That means you got roughly 16 years, actually less, to work with. Israel's going to be 65 in May, okay? So let's say you've got roughly between 15 and 16 years before 2028. If Jesus doesn't come back before 2028, he's not coming. Okay? If he doesn't come back before 2028, he's not coming. Because the scripture, he's put an expiration date on the Bible now here. When he said in Matthew 24, 32 through 34, that this generation would not pass until all these things were fulfilled, he put an expiration date on it. He said that once you see these things and you know the generation has started, that the generation will not pass away until everything has been fulfilled. So we know we have 15 years left in the generation, between 15 and 16, before the generation is 80 years old. Okay? That's 2028. Now, at the very furthest, that means that if Jesus waits till the very last minute before the generation is over, that's 2028. You have a 7-year tribulation that has to fit in there. So that backs us up to 2021 as the very latest the tribulation period can start. Although I don't think it's going to wait till the very latest, and I'll show you that as we keep going. Now, we have other clues to figure in. We know that Israel starts burning weapons after the first four seal judgments have been opened and run their course, and the wars are over. So Israel burns weapons for 7 years, but they can only burn them up until the trib midpoint, the middle of the 7 years, because they flee at the tribulation midpoint into the mountain as Israel is overrun by the Antichrist. So Israel has to start burning weapons by 2017. That means the wars have to be over and Israel starts burning weapons no later than 2017, although it could come sooner. I think it's entirely possible that we're looking a couple of years sooner because maybe, 2, maybe 3 years sooner because those are the latest, the very latest, remember? Okay, and the Lord does say he shortens the days. So he's saying that he's not going to wait till the very last minute, and he shortens those days. And I was asking God, I was thinking about, well, how much does he shorten it by? And I was asking him about that. I didn't really expect him to give me an answer, but he did. And when I was praying and studying and thinking about this, I'm thinking, okay, how many days is he shortening this by? And I'm starting to think about Daniel's 70 weeks. The 70 weeks of years that were given to Daniel the prophet. Okay? The tribulation period of 7 years is that final week of years. That's the 70th week of years. Well, the 69th week was concluded when Jesus rode into Jerusalem on the donkey. And they laid the palm branches down and said, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." That was the end of the 69th week. Well, that's not when the clock stopped. There was some time of, you know, a few days between when Jesus rode in on the donkey and the 69th week concluded. The clock kept running, until he was crucified. So I'm thinking that they were already, you know, we had already proceeded for a few days, that many days into the 70th week before the Messiah was cut off. And so you've got a 70th week that remains short a few days, don't you? Because those few days between the time he rode in on the donkey and the time he was crucified were in the 70th week, since the 69th week concluded the day he rode in on the donkey. So however many days there was between when he rode in on the donkey and when he was crucified, that's what I am starting to understand him to communicate to me through the scriptures, that that's how many days he's going to shorten the 70th week. So, but there could, I mean, I think shortening the days has several references there. There's one that refers to the sun being hot and scorching men with fire. So I think he actually literally shortens the days of daylight, you know, actually shortens the daylight hours so the sun won't be so brutal, because it'll scorch you and burn you and blister you with fire if it even comes in contact with your skin. So we're back to 2017, right? That's the latest for Israel to start burning weapons, but they could burn them sooner. And if the tetrads of blood moons, now let me explain what those tetrads are for those of you that don't know. The tetrad of blood moons are full moons, blood red moons, and not just full blood red moons. They have to fall precisely on Passover and Tabernacles of the same year, and then do it again the very next year, 2 years in a row, to where you have four blood moons all on the feast days, 2 years in a row. That's a tetrad, okay? When the tetrads have appeared before, they have indicated these Israeli wars, where Israel would win and capture more land every time. But there's only two of them in this generation to compare with. Now, there may be something else that they're indicating, but that's all I can tell, you know, from what I'm studying, that they indicate is Israel's wars where they gain more land, because you didn't have any tetrads of blood moons, you know, during all their little incursions into Gaza to clean up and all their little, you know, spats they have here and there with Hezbollah and Syria and, you know, all of these things. That's true, Janine. She says winter days are shorter. Oh, hi, Sherry. Sherry says the days are already shorter. That's true. You know, we've had some quakes that have actually sort of shortened the days a little bit, haven't we? Well, we've got some interesting times ahead of us, because let's say the wars do start between spring and fall of 2014. Like the tetrads indicate, okay? Let's just say hypothetically for a second. I love you too, Sherry. Let's say for a second that the tetrads do indicate the wars, and that the wars will start between spring and fall festivals of 2014. And then we're going to have to consider an element of how long do the wars last. And we, you know, there's no way we can know that. Although warfare nowadays, you know, is pretty short, unless you're the United States and you go into Afghanistan and Iraq for 15 years. Okay. So, there's some things I got to talk to you about, though, guys. Well, let me finish my subject here. Boy, we got a bunch of really amazing stuff to talk about. Okay. So let's say the wars do start in 2014 between spring and fall, like the Tetrads say. See that? If so, if those wars are over by 2015 or sometime, you know, even in 2014, I don't really see those wars lasting for 2 or 3 years all the way to 2017. I think once it gets nuclear, it's going to get, you know, it'll be over quickly, hopefully. And we know that the Arabs who come against Jerusalem will turn on each other and kill one another, which may actually happen in Syria as well. You know, you've got Turkey threatening Syria. It's possible Turkey could nuke Damascus. Turkey would love to nuke Damascus. Now, I don't know if Turkey has nukes or not, but Turkey's NATO, so Turkey can get them, okay? And knows people it has. So, and Russia, you know, they've got 1,000 suitcase bombs that are out there somewhere. God only knows where. You know, but, okay, so if the wars start in 2014, and are over by 2015. Israel could start burning weapons by 2015. But see, 2017 is the latest. That's the very latest that they have to start burning weapons in order for this to all play out by the end of the generation. Okay, so what has to come before the wars? Before the wars, you have the Antichrist rising to power. Okay, he is going forth conquering and to conquer, which, you know, we already have a guy out there who sure looks, you know, fits the description in a lot of ways, and is going forth. He's not really conquering, though. He's toppling, but he's not conquering anything for the USA, that's for sure. He's conquering for Islam. So, but he may not be. I really do think that he's just not impressive enough to be the Antichrist. I think it will probably be the next EU president. They're already wanting to elect a leader. I think it will probably, he will probably come out of the EU elections for president, because, see, this guy is going to rule for 42 months. Well, our president doesn't rule for 42 months. He rules for 4 years. That's 48 months. Okay, so unless we're destroyed at the 42-month mark, but then that wouldn't make sense. He's already ruled for over 42 months, right? He's already been in office 4 years. The Antichrist is only supposed to be in power for 42 months before he's mowed down. Obama's already been in there longer than that, so he may be a front runner. Okay, he is preparing the world to look to one man for all of their answers. So, the Antichrist has to rise to power, which, what I think he needs to do by the end of 2013 for the wars to start between spring and fall of 2014. You know, these things are going to happen pretty fast, but pretty fast doesn't mean all one day after another, all, you know, bam, 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 bam. It means they're going to start, and I think we are going to have, you know, the triple whammy, the rapture, which triggers the global meltdown, financial meltdown, and then that triggers the toppling of the sovereign government. And that sets the Antichrist up real pretty for him to come in and walk in. There's a power vacuum with the rapture having already taken place. He snags authority, goes forth conquering and to conquer. There go the wars. Because see, when he steps up, he's got the solution. Okay? Don't worry, everybody, about the economic system. We just happen to have a brand new one sitting right here in the wing. Don't worry, everybody, about all the about your security and all these governments falling. We've got a world government all ready to go, sitting right here in the wings, just waiting for this to happen. So, yeah, and then later on, you know, you're talking about a one world religion as well, which they've already started forming. They've met at the UN every year since their formation. And do you know they include everyone, including Jews, but won't include Christians? They will not include biblical Christianity in their one world religion. And did you know that is the only religion on the planet that they have refused to include? Did you know that? That's another thing that tells me it's the truth. It's the only one that stands alone. It stands apart from all the others. It's constantly distinguished out. It's constantly filtered out and not accepted. That's why I know it's the truth. It's the only one that's not accepted. They even accept the Jewish religion into their one world religion. Did you know that? Not biblical Christianity, though. You know why? They say that we are arrogant. Because we can't play well with others because we feel like we have the only way to get to heaven. Well, we do have the only way to get to heaven. And Jesus Christ himself said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father except by me. That's what he said. That's what the man said. So, you have to have the rapture, then the rise of the Antichrist, then the wars, then Israel burns weapons. And they're also burying bodies for 7 months after these wars are over. Okay? After the wars are over, after they bury the bodies, after they burn weapons for 3.5 years after the wars, then is when the Antichrist brokers the peace treaty, and Israel will sign it only. See, Israel is going to come out on top in these wars. And the only incentive Israel has to sign that treaty is going to be the one that's going to be offered to them, which is the ability to rebuild their temple on the Temple Mount. See, Israel, after they kick, you know, all this Arab tail all over the place again, Israel has no incentive whatsoever to enter into a peace treaty with these people. And Israel says, nah, no thanks, you know. And then, so the Antichrist is forced to sweeten the deal to where Israel can't refuse. He goes for their heart. He goes for what he knows they want. You know, the devil's always willing to give you exactly what you want, but it's a price, isn't it? But what's funny is, how do you make a deal with the father of lies and then expect him to keep his word? That's what cracks me up when people say they sold their soul to the devil, made a deal with the devil. I'm like, he's a liar. How do you know he's going to keep his end of the bargain? You know, you're expecting him? You're expecting the father of lies to be honest with you? It's killing me. The temples are not built yet. The temple, they're prepared to build it the minute they get the peace treaty, though. They've already got all the money. They've got the Sanhedrin chosen. They have a Sanhedrin now for the first time in 2,000 years. They have the ashes of the red heifer to cleanse the area of the temple. They have the two cornerstones already carved, and they can't be carved with metal tools. I mean, with steel or lead. They have to be these cornerstones have to be carved with brass tools, and they have been, just as they were supposed to. The anointing oil has been found, which is vital for the temple. All the furnishings have been created for the temple. You've got all the priesthood chosen. You have all the priesthood garments are done. The priests are in training to do their temple duties for the first time in 2,000 years. They have everything ready. They just need the peace treaty to be able to build it. Now, what Israel will do is, you know what the tabernacle is, right? That's the tent temple that they had out in the wilderness. Well, when Israel gets the authorization to rebuild through the peace treaty, they will erect the tent tabernacle on the Temple Mount overnight, and they'll build the temple around it while they are conducting their sacrifices and things like that and their rituals from the tent tabernacle. And they'll build the temple around it. And so they're ready right now. If you go to the Temple Institute's website, you can actually take a virtual tour of the new temple. They've released the blueprints and the virtual tour to where you can see what it's going to look like on the inside. You might want to go and check that out, you know, at the Temple Institute, their website. But you know what? The temple cannot be constructed until the treaty is signed, okay? And the temple is Israel's incentive to sign the treaty, okay? Now, I don't know if there'll be a land exchange with that or what, but I know that Israel will rebuild the temple, and they'll rebuild the temple during the first half of the tribulation period. And you know how fast they do these things now. It's a huge complex, but, you know, they're pretty fast these days. How's it going in the chat room? Is everybody okay? Looks like everything's all right. Okay. Now, the temple, you know, we're not going to be around to see that. It will be rebuilt during the tribulation period. And that reminds me back to what we were talking about, Daniel's 70th week. One of the reasons why you have the law in effect during the tribulation period is because that is Daniel's 70th week of years. That is the Old Testament stuff, my friends. Old Testament. Daniel's 70th week is Old Testament. But what happened is when the king was crucified, God stopped the clock, okay? And he put a parenthesis in there. Does that look like a parenthesis? He stopped the clock and he put a parenthesis in there. So he's put the OT on hold, right? Just freeze it where it's at. He opens up a parenthesis in time known as the Age of Grace or the Church Age. During this period of time, you can't see me? Oh, Cuban, you got some issues with our video? That's okay. You can still hear me, right? Means I can eat a couple of these blue M&Ms and nobody will see me do it, doesn't it? CUBN, can you help us out on the video? Please? Anyway, I'm going to keep talking, okay? Because it don't matter what I look like, but I got some important things to tell you while I'm eating these M&Ms. Okay. Now, so we know the numbers at the latest only give us like 2.5 years on our timeline to play with. Okay? Between where we are right now and where all this is going. Now, I know a lot of people think that there's only 7 years left after the rapture. But you know what? There's not a thing that says that. There are, however, events that must take place between the rapture and the start of the tribulation period, like all four of the first seal judgments must be opened first. Because, see, you can't have the... Once the treaty is signed... Wow, did I just... Once the treaty is signed, then starts the 7-year tribulation period. Well, we know that the treaty, once it's signed, isn't broken for 3.5 years. It stays in effect 3.5 years. So, oh, you want the red M&M? Sherry, here you go. There's the red one. Okay. I'll eat it for you while I'm... Okay. Now, here we go. You're welcome. It tasted good. I tasted it for you, too. It was even good. Okay. you got this parentheses in time. Help me, Mikey. And the OT is put on hold, frozen in his tracks. You know, kind of. Then you have this parentheses in time, which is 2,000 years. It tells us in the book of Hosea that after 2 days, see, in the book of Peter, I think it's 2 Peter, tells us that a day is as 1,000 years and 1,000 years is as 1 day. Now, the book of Hosea tells us that after 2 days, from the time Messiah is cut off, 2 days later or 2,000 years later, that the Lord would revive Israel as a nation and they would live once again in his sight. And so they have. 2,000 years later, you have Israel, a nation. That's phenomenal. That's a miracle. It's amazing. See, now Israel is living in his sight. We know this is the prophetic generation. And what I was saying about the peace treaty. Once the peace treaty is signed, we know that it is not broken for 3.5 years. So that means these wars have to take place before that peace treaty is signed. Because it's not the Arabs that invades when the peace treaty is broken. It's the Antichrist. And if the wars with the Arabs happened after the peace treaty was signed, the Antichrist is obligated by his part of the treaty to intervene on Israel's behalf. And we know that that doesn't happen in these wars. That the West just sits back and says, oh, are you come to take a spoil, to take wealth, to gather wealth and things like that? Because the famine, I mean, it's going to hit us really hard right between the eyes. They're already saying that's the third seal judgment. They're already saying that the famine is going to hit everybody really hard by spring. Okay? So, man, bad news. Cuban, let's just totally skip this break here at the bottom of the hour. Okay? Let's just skip it. I got too many things to say. Because we haven't even got to the news yet. And I've still got some really important information to go through. Thank you. I appreciate that. Okay. Now, here's the event. You've got the rapture that has to occur first. The Antichrist can't rise in authority without it, because right now we've got the authority. As long there's not a single scripture in the entire Bible that retracts our authority. Did you know that? That means we have to be removed from the entire planet to where there is not a single living heir to the kingdom on the planet at that moment. Okay? All of those left behind are not saved. None of them are saved. They all have to find Jesus if they're left behind. But the believers are the heirs to the inheritance. And we're the ones with the authority. So we are. The restrainer of evil, which is the Holy Spirit in us, is removed from the equation. That gives a power vacuum where the Antichrist can step right in there, take that authority that's given him by the first seal judgment, and then you move on into the wars. Okay? Remember, the Antichrist is setting up his new financial system, his new global economic system. He's gathering his world government under his authority, which is already out there, the UN, NATO, all that kind of stuff. And then you have the wars that are ignited by a different spirit than the Antichrist. Okay? They are ignited by the red horse, a spirit that rides the red horse that takes peace from the earth. So here's what we're going to, here's what we're looking at. Between now and let's see, what is this? It's November. December to December, that's 12. January, February, March. We're looking at about 15 months before the tetrads indicate that the wars could start. And you know what? That is going to be about as much time as what it's going to take between the rapture and the war starting. Did you know that? I think so, anyway. That's why I think that we could be raptured any day, any hour, any minute. Because there are, you know, you know how our world works. I mean, nothing happens really, really fast, okay? Things have a process. There's a process to things. Because once the rapture occurs, the world, whole world is stunned. People are going to go crazy when they can't find their children. You're looking at every baby and young child on the planet vanishing. That's going to wig the whole planet out. And the Antichrist will be the only one who can get a grip on the world and restore it to some kind of sanity. The people will look to him for answers, and God only knows what he's going to say as an explanation for the rapture. But you can bet your bippy that it's not exactly what happened, okay? He's going to say, you know what? Those were the tares. They had to be removed. But before you buy that bull, start thinking. Use your brain. Ask yourself, so little tiny babies and little children who are unaccountable are wicked and considered tares? No. It doesn't make sense, does it? If the children leave, then they've been rescued. Okay? They are not tares. Tares are the Nephilim. The tares are not pure human. They're a hybrid between fallen angel and human. They're also known as demigods. Okay? You've seen all about them on TV. Percy Jackson and the Lightning Thief. Thor. You've got all of these. All these stories about what these are is fallen angels in human bodies. You know, these bodies are made in a lab that they use, and they step in them and drive them like avatars. And they are not human, okay? They have a human body, but what's on the inside is not a human soul like what's on the inside of us. Okay, now I don't want to get off on that, but do you see on the timeline where the rapture could, by God's watchman, I'm glancing at it, I'm not seeing it constantly. Let's see. Is there any questions I need to be noticing? Why is the chat like upside down? What I mean is instead of top to bottom, it's newest on the bottom and then it scrolls up. Yes, that's right. That's right. Wonder Woman, that's correct. The giants, Goliath had six fingers and six toes. Yes, I'm trying to read it and keep up with it. Any questions over there? Why are the sun rises and sunsets horizon-wise off even before the bigger quakes? Well, I think that we've had the Earth tilt on its axis further because we've got... people who have really amazing technology out there who are doing some experimentation, okay? I think that's why we were showing about how Sandy, yes, that's exactly right, the heart. Yeah, we showed how, you know, Sandy was a manufactured storm. It started to die down way down there between Cuba and Florida, and all of a sudden that you can see these chemical dumps that they put in it to fire that baby right back up. Yes, they caused the Japan quake. They caused, well, I'll tell you how. Here's the thing. We know they caused Sandy because we saw the chemical dumps on the radar, on the satellite photos. Then you have 2 feet of this weird-looking foam that washes up with the storm all along the East Coast. And they're like, wow, what's this? It looked like snow. It was like 2 feet deep, seriously. Deeper than knee deep. So then, I'm starting to remember, the first time we saw this weird foam was with Irene. Remember? Hurricane Irene. That means they've been manufacturing storms at least that long that Irene was manufactured, if it had the foam from those chemical dumps. With normal storms, you don't get 2 feet of a snow-like chemical foam washing up on the shore on the entire length of the East Coastline. You know, Lisa, do children in the womb get raptured? If their mother is raptured, they do. If their mother is not raptured, they have to stay because, remember, you have to be born of water and of the spirit, okay? Those children are not born of water yet if they're still in the womb. If their mother is lost, they have to stay inside their mother. Okay? They're not born of water yet, so they can't be taken. But if the mother is a believer, then they get to go by default because the mother goes. Okay? Yes, the unborn child does get raptured with the mother. But a pregnant woman does not simply have an empty belly. Because the baby has not been born of water. And the scripture says you have to be born of water and of spirit. You know, we were talking about, no, unborn babies do not get raptured unless they go with their mothers. The scripture says you must be born of spirit and water. Now, I just was teaching a lesson on being born again. It's really easy. Do you understand what it means to be born again? It's not some, you know, poof of a magic wand from fairy godmother or a puff of smoke or, you know, something kind of booming thing from the sky. What it means, what being born again means is that you are not the person that you were. Well, how does that happen? Well, here's how it happens. Romans 12:2 says, "Be ye not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind." Okay? So what you do to be born again is you receive the Lord Jesus Christ, you open your Bible, and you get the Word inside you. And when you get the Word inside you, it changes how you think. It reprograms you. So you are not the same person that you were before. Okay? Let me give you an example. Let's say, you know, when you've gone to the store and been given a little extra change back that you weren't supposed to get. Well, before you know Jesus, you're walking out with a big smile on your face thinking you came out real good. Okay? Because the cashier didn't catch it. Well, but once you know Jesus, you don't think like that anymore. What you do is you bring it to the cashier's attention and you say, "I'm sorry, I believe this is wrong. I think I owe you more money." You think differently. After the Word transforms your mind, you're not the same person that you were. After you get the Word in you, you don't think the same. Where you might have driven by a woman with children trying to change her own tire, after you know Jesus and have the Word in you, you're not going to drive right past her. You're going to stop and help her. Well, that's not the same person you were, is it? The Word, when you get it into you, changes how you think. It reprograms your brain. And when your brain, if your brain is reprogrammed, then you're not the same person, are you? I mean, I may still be Lisa to everybody who knows me, but I'm not the same Lisa that they knew when I was 20 years old because I think totally different. I act totally different. I am totally different. I used to be a pro cheerleader for the North American Soccer League Tulsa Roughnecks in 1981. I got out there in my fringy little uniform shaking my stuff for the games and being a cheerleader for the team. Well, that's not who I am anymore, okay? That was me, but that's not me now, okay? I would not put on a skimpy, fringy uniform now and get out there and shake my stuff in anyone's face anymore. That's not who I am anymore. But it used to be who I was. You know, it used to be who I was. That's who I was, and that's what I did. But that's not who I am now. I am never going to, you know, dress skimpy like that and shake my stuff on television like back then, okay? That's not who I am anymore. I have no desire to do that. I have no, that's just not who I am or what I want anymore. And the difference is the Word of God. When you get the Word of God in you, it changes the way you think. And when it changes the way you think, you become a new creation. Okay? You're not the person you were. You know? Maybe injustice didn't bother you before you got born again. But after you got the word inside you, now all of a sudden it bothers you. Why? Because you're a new creation. Because you think different than you used to. That's what being born again is. It's not some mystical, mythical thing. It's, you know, we serve a real God who we can serve for real in a practical and logical sense. And none of this stuff God does is mystical. All that mystical junk is dark, okay? Jesus is real. He does things in the real, and the things make sense. So being born again is getting the word inside your brain, letting it reprogram how you think to where you think like the Lord. You think like God thinks and not like a sinful man thinks anymore. And that is how you are born again. Once the word transforms your mind, you are born again. Okay, I still haven't got to what I really wanted to get to you guys. But does everyone understand what it means to be born again? That you're not the same person you were. There's no magical poof to it. No fairy godmother with a wand. All it is getting the word inside your brain, letting it reprogram the way you think. And then you think like a new creation. You think totally differently. You're a whole different person than you were. And that's what being born again is, okay? And you must be born again. If you prayed the prayer and you've never got the word inside you, you can't be changed. How can you be changed by it if you don't ever get it inside you? And if you never get it inside you and never are changed, you are never born again, which means you're not going nowhere, okay? So get in your Bible and ask the King to change you with it. Okay, we don't have much time for you to do that. So if you've not been born again, according to the way we just talked about it, get in your Bible, pray, tell the King to please do a really quickie transformation on you to where you're born again. Learn the word, believe it, obey it. Okay, obey the King, and that's how you activate the Holy Spirit in yourself, and that's where the miracles come from. Okay. Now, in the last few minutes here, I want to run. Dang, I can't believe this show has. Cuban, can I ask you a question? Is there any way we can go another hour? If there's not, I understand. But if there's any way that we can go another hour, I need another hour. Okay, until I find out from him, we'll see. Are you guys okay with that if we go another hour, if Cuban can pull it off?
Go another hour?
I mean, can you guys handle that? Okay. He says he can give us an extra 45 minutes. I'll take it. Thank you. We'll go till 7:45 Eastern time. That would be 6:45 Central. Okay, if you guys can handle that, yay. Okay, if you guys can handle that, we're going to go ahead and do it because I've just got too much info to give you here that's really important, okay? And I want to catch you up on the news as well. We still haven't even talked about the news. We've spent the last 2 hours just talking about being born again and talking to the Muslims and updating what's going on in Israel and Gaza. Okay. So here we go. What I want to do now is clue you in on what is going on in the news. Okay. Now I'm going to pick out only the really important stuff. I'm not going to nitpick you to death with all the little stupid stuff. Okay. We got a lot of big things going on right now. Okay. Cuban, can we go to a very short break at the top of the hour, and then we'll just go for all the rest of it after that, if that's okay. All right. Now, Israel has sent Hamas a 36-hour ultimatum. Okay? And I think we need to talk about this. This is from Aretz Sheva in Israel. Aretz Sheva. Aretz Sheva. Isn't that fun? I love to speak Hebrew. I don't know any of it. I need to take Hebrew. We're all going to be speaking it one of these days, so it'd be good to learn it. Diplomatic message to Egypt. Hamas terrorism must cease by Tuesday evening or we step up attack. So Israel has sent Hamas a 36-hour ultimatum through Egypt. Now, Egypt, you know, they don't like Israel. So we'll just have to see how this goes. Israel has delivered an ultimatum to Hamas through Egypt, according to which the IDF will widen its offensive in Gaza in 36 hours unless Hamas ceases firing rockets and smuggling arms into Gaza, IDF radio reported Monday morning. Finance Minister Yuval Steinitz told the station that the time left before Israel steps up its attack can be measured in hours, not days. We are at a junction, he said. Either we go toward a calm or toward a meaningful widening of the operation, including a possible move to achieve complete military decision. There are ongoing contacts between Israel and Hamas through intermediaries, IDF radio said, but the gaps between the sides are still very large. How large? Looks to me like Gaza and Hamas are so outgunned that all they need to do is just go like this and stop fighting. So they'll live. They're just so outgunned it's not even funny. Uh-oh. Okay. We've got more stuff happening. Just okay, let me go over it. All right. There are ongoing contacts between Israel and Hamas through intermediaries, IDF radio said. But the gaps between the sides are still very large. According to reports in Cairo, Hamas demands a complete removal of the blockade on Gaza. Did you hear that? That actually says Hamas demands a complete removal of the blockade on Gaza. Hamas is in no position to demand anything. They're getting their tails blown up. They can't demand nothing. Yeah, they better start. You know, the people of Gaza need to start demanding that Hamas back off of their schools and hospitals and areas where they keep all those children. I mean, that's what the people need to do. They need to go slap Hamas upside the head and say, you keep endangering my children, you're going to deal with me instead of Israel. That's what they should do. Anyway, Israel, for its part, demands that... Israel, for its part, demands that Hamas cease firing rockets into Israel for a period of several years. Because they're like, okay, well, if we sign this, how long do we have to stop firing rockets at you? And Israel's like, several years, okay? And a cessation of arms smuggling into Gaza. Like that's ever going to happen. Israel agrees to Hamas's demand that the Rafah crossing into Egypt be opened, but refuses to open crossings into Israel. So Israel's saying, okay, you want to go back and forth into Egypt, you go right ahead, but you're not coming into Israel. And I don't blame them for that. Hamas official Musa Abu Marzouk said that Hamas will not agree to Israel's demands for a security belt on Gaza's eastern side and a cessation of smuggling through the tunnels. Well, Voice of Israel Public Radio quoted a senior source in Jerusalem as saying that the question of whether Egypt can broker a ceasefire will be resolved Monday. A senior minister said that Israel will have to agree to a certain relaxation of the blockade of Gaza in return for long-term quiet on the southern border. Cuban, I need to ask you a question real quick. I realize our recording may stop at 6. Do you want me to say bye to people at 6 and then continue off the recording to where you can cut it off at 6? I mean, I hate to talk through it. If you need to cut it off at 6, I can say bye to everybody. And then all of these here who are listening live, they can know to stick around. You can let me know. Okay, let's get on with some more news. There's a ton of stuff to go through here, guys. I am serious. Israel has stepped up the targeted attacks on suspected militant sites in Gaza as fighting stretches into a sixth day. It remained unclear who the target of that missile attack was, however. The new tactic ushered in a new and risky phase of the operation, giving the likelihood of civilian casualties in the crowded territory of 1.6 million Palestinians. The rising civilian toll was also likely to intensify. Oops, sorry. I just kicked the camera. That's my bad. Okay. The rising civilian toll was also likely to intensify pressure on Israel to end the fighting. Hundreds of civilian casualties. See, that's what they're trying to do. Hamas wants a huge civilian toll on their side so they can use it in the international community against Israel. That's kind of their strategy. It's not a very good one. Still, hundreds of civilian casualties in an Israeli offensive in Gaza 4 years ago led to fierce international condemnation of Israel. See, that's what they hope for again this time. Obama says we are fully supportive of Israel's right to defend itself, but warns against ramping up. Well, you know what? That he's fully supportive of Israel's right to defend itself is the only thing the man said in the last 4 years I can agree with. Miracles do happen, don't they? Okay. It's final in Ireland. Kids and government rule in the home over parents. The results are in, and parents in Ireland voted for their own defeat, conceding that they are not fit to make decisions about raising their own children. They effectively handed over their parental rights to their own children and the government Saturday, as the final poll results show this week that 57% versus 43% of Irish voters believe that children's rights should usurp their own when making crucial decisions on the upbringing of Irish youth. Well, you know what? Consider your children, of course, above yourself, which is why you don't put them in anyone else's hands or under anyone else's responsibility when you don't know God has entrusted you with their raising as a parent. You know, don't go fluffing off your responsibilities to your kids and dump them on the government and trust the government to raise them. They'll never make it if you do that. You got to take care of your own kids. Okay, you got to hear this. This is just awful, guys. And I mean, I know this will probably upset a lot of you, but try to keep this in perspective, okay? We're going to talk about some of the horrors of the FEMA disaster relief situation and what these people who have been moved to these FEMA camps are experiencing. It's a nightmare. Okay, Black Hawk helicopters patrol the skies. We're going to listen to some testimony of what's going on in these FEMA camps, okay? Ronald Reagan said the 9 most terrifying words in the English language are, "I'm from the government and I'm here to help." Amen to that, President Ronald Reagan. Those wise and yet haunting words spoken by one of our nation's greatest presidents couldn't ring more true, especially today as winter sets in on an estimated 130,000 of our fellow Americans. We're going to go to a break. We'll be right back with lots more news. Oh, I need to say bye. Do I need to? We'll see you tomorrow. Here, there, or in the air. Just in case we're cutting off. Stick around, guys. We're going to stay live.
Welcome to the all-new CBN Gospel from the Christian Broadcasting Network on CBN.com.
In my strong tower, Jesus, my strength this hour, Jesus. In my deliverer, yes, you are, Jesus. My hope in my future, Jesus. Source in my shelter, Jesus. You're my Savior. Lord, I need you to take my hand and see me through. Whoa.
Okay, let me answer Melanie's issue here. Melanie is, she says, I'm still stuck on the unborn children not getting raptured. I always thought that they do get raptured. They're just like the other children that are too young. Well, sweetie, they haven't been born of water, okay? The scripture says that you must be born of water and of spirit. I'll find that scripture for you, babe, and show that to you real quick. Yeah, you must be born of water and of spirit. Now, that doesn't mean that the aborted babies didn't go straight to heaven, okay? As they were aborted, they were born of water. Their water sac was broken when they were aborted, all right? So they are born of water even though they are aborted, okay? You have to be born of water and of spirit. Let me that for you. Who would have thought? Wow. He was talking to Nicodemus. Let's get in here. Where is it? Let me look up another reference here. Let's try. You can't do anything without a concordance, you know it? If you know even one word in a verse, then you can find the verse. Now, I'm trying to think of the verse I want and looking for the most unusual word in the verse that would be used less so I can find it easier. Okay. Let's see. What is that? That is John. Okay. Now we're looking at John 3:5, Melanie, sweetheart. It says, Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, that's the renewing of your mind with the word, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. So you have to be born of water. Okay? Now a baby in utero is not yet born of water. Okay? They're still in the water. They haven't been born yet. Now, Jesus can't just take them, okay? If they have unbelieving parents, Jesus cannot just take them. Now, if they're born already, even if they're 5 minutes old, he can take them. But not until they are born of water and are actually out into the world, he can't take them. Unless they are inside their believing mother, okay? Then they automatically go. He's not going to take the mother and leave the baby. You know, he's going to take them both if the mother's saved. But if the mother is not saved, the unborn child does not just disappear from her womb. That baby has to be born. Okay? And there are a lot of babies who are going to be born after the tribulation period starts. Here's the thing. I mean, God takes them all at that one certain point, but as children continue to be born, I mean, at some point, you know, once he's come, you know, there's just no way to take them all because you're going to have pregnancies during the trib and all that. He has to cut it off somewhere and rapture everybody, all the children, all the babies. And then the ones that are born after that, you know, they'll die during the tribulation period, but they'll end up in heaven too. Okay. They just will not be coming back alive in flesh bodies like those who are raptured will. Okay? So, let's see. Are you guys ready to hear about these FEMA camps? This is a nightmare. Seriously. I mean, I was reading this and I'm sitting there thinking, okay, Melanie says, but the children are not born of spirit when they are too young to understand. Well, no, they're not. The children are unaccountable. See, you're unaccountable until you're old enough to understand right from wrong. So, you know, while you're still unaccountable and really young, you go. Okay? It's kind of like, you know, if a two-year-old dies, they automatically go to heaven because they're unaccountable. And the rapture is a gauge. Anybody who would go to heaven if they died at that moment will get raptured. Anybody who would go to hell at that moment will stay here. Okay? Yes, when you get raptured, you get new bodies that never die again. Well, our same bodies are actually regenerated. You know, you're going to look exactly like you look now. You're going to look like yourself, except perfected. You know, if you got a little extra weight on you, which... you know, I do. And I got this, you know, tummy in front that, you know, after a vertical emergency C-section, those muscles just don't work like they used to. Okay? And all that will be restored. You'll be perfect. You'll be the best you can possibly be. Okay? Your body will be somewhere between 25, 30 years old probably. And you'll still be you. The you are now, when you are in your new body, everybody will recognize you. Those who knew you already, you'll still know all of that. Okay. Well, honey, she says it seems unfair for them to get taken and not the unborn. Well, how would you suggest that the Lord do that if you don't think that he's got it figured out the right way? You got a better idea? I'm all ears if you got a better idea, you know. You know, it's not unfair and it's not unjust, okay? he can't take them, I don't think. I mean, I could be wrong about that. If it makes you feel better to think he takes them, you're welcome to think whatever you want. I'm just having trouble, I'm just having trouble justifying that with scripture. But it's not a salvation issue, so you, if it makes you feel better to think he takes them, then think he takes them. That's no big deal. Okay, let's go ahead and move on. Let's see. What have we got here? Wonder Woman is praying. She says, Heavenly Father, we lift up Clinna's daughter Ashley to you. Now, do you have, we got a situation going on here with that we need to pray for? She says, we ask that you draw her to yourself, Lord. Please save her. God, send the Holy Spirit in a powerful way. We pray that you open her eyes to the truth and show her the need for a Savior. Please, for Jesus' sake, block the enemy, soften her heart, remove the delusion that has been put over her. Have mercy, O God, and free her from unclean spirits. We love you, Lord, and thank you for your tender mercies. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, I'll add my voice to that too, and I'll say amen as well. Let it be written and done. Okay, let's move on. Melanie, honey, it's all right. If you want to feel like he takes them, you go right ahead. You could be right. I just can't find any scriptural, certainty on that. What I believe I see in the scriptures, I could be wrong. Hey, I'm only human, so we'll hope I'm wrong on that one, okay? I'm good with that. Okay, let's get into this FEMA stuff, because this is scary, guys. I'm serious. This is horrifying. Now, get this. I told you the words of President Reagan. The 9 most terrifying words in the English language are, I'm from the government and I'm here to help. Well, he says, those wise and yet haunting words spoken by one of our nation's greatest presidents couldn't ring more true, especially today as winter sets in on an estimated 130,000 of our fellow Americans who are still struggling without power. Many live without heat, hot water, or habitable homes, and question the government's efforts to alleviate their condition. Amid the election frenzy, several mainstream media outlets instantly praised the Obama administration's response to the Hurricane Sandy devastation in the Northeast. But let's look beneath the congratulatory headlines to see the real and horrifying picture of what's really happening. Right now, homeless Americans are literally freezing, wrapped in blankets and trash bags as they struggle to survive in FEMA tent cities such as New Jersey's Camp Freedom, which reportedly resembles a prison camp. Sitting there last night, you could see your breath, displaced resident Brian Sotelo told the Asbury Park Press. At Pine Belt, the Red Cross made an announcement that they were sending us to permanent structures up here that had just been redone, that had washing machines and hot showers and steady electric, and they sent us instead to a tent city. They're like, oh, come on, we've got these wonderful places to send you, hot showers, newly remodeled, steady electric, to get them on the bus. And then once they get them on the bus, they take them and they take them to a tent city where they're freezing to death. And Sotelo said Black Hawk helicopters patrol the skies all day and night with a black car with tinted windows surveying the camp while the government moves heavy equipment past the tents at night. According to the story, reporters aren't even allowed in the fence complex where lines of displaced residents form outside portable toilets. Security guards are posted at every door, and residents can't even use the toilet or shower without first presenting ID. What is this? They treat us like we're prisoners, Ashley Sabol told Reuters. It's bad to say, but we honestly feel like we're in a concentration camp. Snow and icy slush seep into living areas through the bottoms of the government tents. Meanwhile, officials are said to be banning residents from taking pictures and even cutting off Wi-Fi and power access. After everyone started complaining and they found out we were contacting the press, they brought people in, Sotelo said. Every time we plugged in an iPhone or something, the cops would come and unplug them. He added, everybody is angry over here. It's like being in prison. In New York, residents of Garrison Beach have banded together to survive. With all due respect to the federal issue, we're used to taking care of ourselves, Doreen Garson, the acting volunteer fire chief, told the Washington Post as area residents received hot meals outside a trailer. She says, I don't know what FEMA is really doing for anyone. She's right. People need to band together and take care of themselves and not depend on the government to do it. Some citizens say FEMA has distributed checks to fix their homes, but bureaucratic hurdles mean relief amounts are determined inconsistently and may be insufficient to cover damage. In some cases, the rebuilding funds are distributed even when reconstruction doesn't make sense because the destroyed homes are located in high-risk areas. Well, what I want to know is why in the heck FEMA is issuing checks to fix anyone's home. Isn't that why you have insurance? Why are all the rest of us paying for insurance if FEMA is going to give people money to fix their homes back up? Why are we paying for insurance if the government is just going to fix everything that ever goes wrong with your house? Don't trust the government to handle that, okay? Keep your insurance instead. But it is kind of irritating to me personally that you have FEMA dishing out money to people who chose not to purchase insurance on their home. They chose not to purchase insurance, and now they're going to get FEMA money instead of insurance money, and they're going to get their house rebuilt with taxpayers' money when they chose not to carry insurance. When I have to carry insurance, you have to carry insurance. That just doesn't seem right, does it? FEMA's bureaucratic tape is such a mess that states have had to hire consulting firms just to navigate the paperwork, with consultants earning as much as $180 an hour, all of which is billed to American taxpayers. What is with these people? Meanwhile, FEMA, which previously provided trailers to victims of Hurricane Katrina, that was a disaster, remember? That made residents sick from toxic levels of formaldehyde, will now bring more temporary homes to New York and New Jersey. The government assures us that this time the homes have been approved by the Department of Housing and Urban Development. Well, that just makes me feel all warm inside. What about you? In the aftermath of Hurricane Sandy, FEMA failed to have bottled water and other supplies ready for storm victims a week after the storm hit, and was forced to seek help from private vendors to meet residents' needs. Now get this, while generous citizens fill trucks with donations and goods for hurricane survivors, FEMA is reportedly demanding they stop because the federal agency has strict rules on what can and can't be accepted. Whoa! Well, remember us reporting about how those utility workers from Alabama traveled all 800 miles to go up there to that disaster area and offer their services to help get the power back on? That's what they do for Alabama. And these power workers came up there to help everybody get the power back on. And do you know, FEMA turned them back and said, no, you can't come in here and help because you're not union. I'm serious. You are not dreaming. This is not the Twilight Zone. I'm serious. They drove 800 miles to go help get people's power back on and were turned away because they weren't part of a union. You've got to be kidding me. Okay. To make matters worse, FEMA now expects Homeland Security Secretary Janet Napolitano to appear before Congress and request a taxpayer bailout. You remember what happened the last time we got hit with a bailout? For FEMA flood insurance operations. So, in other words, FEMA is acting like an insurance company to people that didn't have insurance, and now they want the taxpayers to bail them out. Well, why in the heck are the rest of us paying for insurance if that's the way it works? I don't believe them. They're full of it. They want a bailout for FEMA flood insurance operations while they burn through $200 to $300 million a day. Nuts. Where'd we go wrong? The moment we began looking to government to fill the role of caretaker, provider, and savior. What happened to the days when communities and churches were the places Americans turned to for help? We need to get back to basics where Americans care for our brothers and sisters and help them in times such as these. In one brilliant example of communities banding together, Staten Island residents organized their own citizen-led team of volunteers and started doing a donation drive, bringing massive trucks of aid into their community from Virginia. They've worked with local churches, VFW posts, and businesses to bring in needed supplies and help with cleanup efforts. In another stunning example of private efforts, veterans of both the Israeli Army and U.S. military descended on New York to help with rescue operations and relief assistance when the government was said to be absent. Churches and businesses are reaching out to people who've been displaced, packing U-Haul trucks and 18-wheelers with food, diapers, blankets, toiletries, and other needed goods. We decided it wasn't enough for us to simply declare the gospel. We've got to demonstrate it, Pastor Jerry Young declared from New Hope Baptist Church in Mississippi. What we're trying to do now is demonstrate the gospel. Just as these grassroots volunteers have been sacrificing so much to help displaced citizens and clean up storm-ravaged areas in the Northeast, I urge America's citizen volunteers, churches, and businesses to follow their examples. Let's stop making the mistake of expecting government to be our savior in times like these. We are told 8 times in the Bible to love our neighbor. This is Thanksgiving week. America has an extraordinary opportunity to do just that. Let's band together and show our fellow citizens that we care and we won't leave them to the mercy of the government in their time of need. Wow. Well, we're running out of time fast, so let me just run through some more of this news. You've had fire exchanges on the Syrian border. Stray Syrian fire hit an IDF patrol in the Golan Heights on Saturday night. No injuries were reported, but an IDF jeep was damaged. This is the fourth such incident recorded in the past week. So we've got Syria and Lebanon up there at the Golan fixing to make big mistakes. The incident began when an IDF patrol was hit by Syrian fire in the Tel Hezekiah area. The IDF fired artillery at the Syrian post in response. Plans for an EU budget without Britain are a slap in the face. I don't think I need to really read that one. Now, here's one that I want to alert you to. We have a giant sun eruption captured in a NASA video. And now I have put this on my Facebook wall so you can see it. The sun unleashed a monster eruption of super hot plasma Friday, November 16th in back-to-back solar storms captured on camera by a NASA spacecraft. The giant sun eruption, called a solar prominence, occurred at 1 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, with another event flaring up 4 hours later. The prominences were so large, they expanded beyond the camera view of NASA's Solar Dynamics Observatory, the SDO, which captured high-definition video of the solar eruption. In the video, a colossal loop of glowing red plasma erupts from the lower left of the sun, arcing up and out of frame as it blasts away from the star. The red glowing looped material is plasma, a hot gas made of electrically charged hydrogen and helium, officials said with NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center, which oversees the SDO mission, explained in a description. The prominence plasma flows along a tangled and twisted structure of magnetic fields generated by the sun's internal dynamo. An erupting prominence occurs when such a structure becomes unstable and bursts outward, releasing the plasma. Friday's solar eruption does not appear to be aimed at Earth, so will likely have little effect on our planet. But that was not the case earlier this week when a powerful solar flare erupted on Monday, November 12th. That flare registered as an M6 class eruption, a moderate but still intense solar event. Well, wow. Now, this is saying on Tuesday and Wednesday, the 13th and 14th of November, space weather conditions sparked a geomagnetic storm that supercharged the Earth's auroras, creating spectacular northern lights displays for observers at high latitudes. When aimed directly at Earth, the most powerful solar flares and eruptions can pose a threat to satellites and astronauts in orbit, and also interfere with communication, navigation, and power systems on the ground. The Sun is currently in the middle of an active phase of its 11-year solar weather cycle. The current cycle is called Solar Cycle 24 and is expected to peak in 2013. Yeah, I figure that too. How about that? Let's see what else we've got. Signs in the Sun, Moon, and Stars, and upon Earth, a distress of nations with perplexity. Massive explosion seen on the Sun. That's the one that we just talked about. Let me see what we're going on. Are we too bright? How's that? Every time I lean forward, it adjusts the brightness. I'm like right up against this thing here. Okay, how are we now? Are we good? All right. Yeah. The EU countries are urging Israel not to invade Gaza, like Israel's going to listen to anything they ever want. Signs in the Sun, Moon, and Stars, and upon Earth, a distress of nations with perplexity, massive explosions seen on the Sun. We are passing through a rare singular series of events in history that are coinciding by occurrence, a total solar eclipse, the peak of the Leonid meteor shower, and a large explosion occurring on the Sun. In fact, signs in the Sun, Moon, and Stars all transpiring within days of each other. Let's see what else we've got. The Egypt's Orthodox Coptic Christians have enthroned in an elaborate ceremony lasting near 4 hours. Their new pope, if you will. Okay, a task force says global shadow banking hit $67 trillion. You have got to be kidding me. That's worse than I ever even thought. A report by the Financial Stability Board, the FSB, on Sunday appeared to confirm fears among policymakers that shadow banking is set to thrive beyond the reach of a regulatory net tightening around traditional banks and their activities. Officials at the European Commission in Brussels see closer control of the sector as important in preventing a repeat of the financial crisis that toppled banks over the past 5 years and rocked the Eurozone. Okay. Ten Commandments judge issues the wake-up call that focuses on, in a phrase, the fact the rights of U.S. citizens come from God and not Washington, and government needs to acknowledge that. Without an understanding of God, he told WorldNet Daily in a recent post-election interview, you can't understand the Constitution. Iran is, of course, building up their weapons manufacturing capabilities. We had a 5.1 mag earthquake in the Philippines today in Mindanao. Erupted locally Monday shortly after 4 a.m. The quake, however, had a substantial depth. USGS indicates to news that the quake struck 78 miles below the Earth's surface. Wow. As a result, the quake's range was limited. Wow. Okay. A female bomber attacks major Pakistani politician. A government official says a female suicide bomber in northwest Pakistan detonated her explosives near the convoy of a former leader of the country's largest Islamist party. Shamsur Rehman Khan says Qazi Hussein Ahmad, the former chief of Jamaat-e-Islami Pakistan, escaped unhurt from the attack Monday in the Momand tribal region. Three of his aides were wounded. What's wrong with people? We saw Israel's Iron Dome work like a charm, didn't we? Isn't that cool? We don't have to read that. After a quiet night, the rockets begin anew in southern Israel. Terrorists in the Gaza Strip renewed their fire on Monday after a relatively quiet night on the Israeli front, setting off the red alerts in southern towns. A total of 7 rockets landed in open fields outside Eshkol and Sha'ar HaNegev, causing no injuries or damage, Army Radio reported. See, that's why nobody is even considering these rockets an aggression. There's 1,000 rockets being fired at Israel. There's 1 million people in the shelters, and all of these people on the Palestinian side are going, "Oh, those rockets aren't hurting you. Why are you throwing such a fit? They all land out in the field." Well, it's not because they don't try to kill them, you know, kill the Israelis with them. They're just either stupid, don't know how to operate the equipment, or the Lord our God is intervening on Israel's behalf and diverting and deflecting those missiles. Okay? And that is entirely possible. Okay, we've got the Nikkei hit a 2-month high on hopes of easing after the election. It climbed for a 4th day to a 2-month high on Monday on growing expectations that Japan's main opposition party will win next month's election and step up pressure on the central bank to ease monetary policy. Israeli websites are under heavy attack. The Israeli government said that its websites logged about 44 million hacking attempts following the bombardment of Gaza Strip since Wednesday. Yuval Steinitz, country's finance minister, said that an unnamed government website was successfully hacked only once, but it was back online after 10 minutes. 44 million hacking attempts. Whoa! That's amazing. Okay, and on this ridiculous public nudity ban considered in San Francisco, the San Franciscans may be forced to wear clothes outside of their homes. Wah, wah, wah. It makes for a whole lot better view, you know, if you put clothes on. And some nude activists aren't pleased. Well, walk around your house naked, okay? Close your curtains and just walk all over your house naked as a jaybird if that's what you want to do. Just don't subject the rest of us to have to look at you, okay? I don't care how good your body is. The human body needs clothes on it, okay? That's the first thing God did was put clothes on Adam and Eve. He didn't want to look at them either. San Franciscans, the city lawmakers are scheduled to vote Tuesday on an ordinance that, if passed, would make it illegal for anyone over the age of 5 to expose their genitals in public. Exemptions will be made for parades and festivals. Can you believe that really says that? That's like reality that says that. It says exemptions where you can go naked, okay, will be made for parades and festivals. Oh, dear Lord. Who wants to see that at a parade or a festival held under a city permit, according to the ordinance? Ah, remind me never to go to San Francisco, okay? That's scary. I don't want to see some crusty old man walking down the street naked. Ooh, I don't even want to see a real good-looking young guy walking down the street naked because he looks way better with his clothes on. But don't go lusting after anybody that looks good. But, you know, that would sure cure the world, wouldn't it, of lust if you stuck all those naked bodies in everyone's face. Everybody would be going, oh, that's horrible. I don't even want to look at my own body, let alone subject some poor soul to have to look at it. That's horrible. You know, Congress is wanting to know who created the Benghazi talking points and why terrorism link was omitted. That's a stinky situation with the government, isn't it? And falls all right there in Obama's lap. Ranchers and farmers are bracing for the death tax impact. Rancher Kevin Kester works dawn to dusk, drives a 12-year-old pickup truck, and earns less than a typical bureaucrat in Washington. Yet the federal government considers him rich enough to pay the estate tax, also known as the death tax. And with that tax set to soar, not creep up a little bit, soar at the beginning of 2013 without some kind of intervention from Congress, Farmers and ranchers like Kester are waiting anxiously. There is no way financially my kids can pay what the IRS is going to demand from them 9 months after death and keep this ranch intact for their generation and future generations, said Kester of the Bear Valley Ranch in Central California. 2 decades ago, Kester paid the IRS $2 million when he inherited the 22,000-acre cattle ranch from his grandfather. Come January, the tax burden on his children will be more than $13 million. See, they make you pay for the same property generation after generation after generation. And that's just wrong. He says here, the tax burden will be more than $13 million on his ranch for his children. For supporters of a high estate tax, which is imposed on somebody's estate after death, Kester is the kind of person they rarely mention. He doesn't own a mansion. He's not the CEO of a multinational company. But because of his line of work, he owns a lot of property that would be subject to a lot of tax. He runs a ranch. Our number one goal is to repeal the estate tax, to get rid of it, not have it for every generation when I die and my kids die and so on, he told Fox News. For everyone to have to repurchase, and that's what this is, for everyone to have to repurchase the ranch or farm over and over for each generation, that's inherently unjust. So what we're doing is asking our politicians to understand that and repeal the estate tax. That, however, is unlikely. Currently, the federal government taxes estates worth $5 million and up at 35%. When the Bush-era tax rates expire in January, rates increase 20% to 55% of estates of $1 million or more. Wow. You don't even have to have anything, and you're going to get taxed at 55%. $1 million is not that much money. Well, I mean, it sounds like a lot to me, but to a rancher, you know, he's got 22,000 acres. He's running a ranch there, and they're charging him. They charge him $2 million to inherit it. They're going to charge his children $13 million to inherit it. That's just wrong. It's like they're stealing the people's land from them. And that, you know, they're coming across here saying, well, their goal is to recover and retake all private property. They don't want anybody to have private property anymore. And that's true. While some Republicans want to eliminate the death tax entirely, President Obama has proposed a 45% rate on taxes on estates of $3.5 million and up. Isn't that awful? Congress is demanding the EPA's secret email accounts. Syrian rebels capture the airport. There's optimism between Obama and the Congress leaders over the fiscal cliff. Yeah, right. Sure. Says Nancy Pelosi. Okay, consider the source. Palestinian Authority warns of chaos in the West Bank. Now, this is important. We better talk about this. Palestinian Authority warned Saturday of chaos in the West Bank in response to the ongoing IDF operation. In the Gaza Strip, okay? The warning came as Palestinians staged demonstrations in various parts of the West Bank in protest against the IDF offensive. Many protesters carried Hamas green flags and chanted slogans calling on the Islamic movement's armed wing Izzadin Qassam brigades to destroy Tel Aviv. Dream on! You're not going to destroy Tel Aviv, okay? Now, the day may come when you're going to, you know, you'll probably kill a few people, but it's not today. In Ramallah, hundreds of demonstrators marched toward IDF soldiers stationed near Ofer Prison on the southern outskirts of the city. At least 7 protesters were injured, 4 of them seriously, when IDF soldiers fired rubber bullets and tear gas toward the crowd. See, they got rubber bullets just because, you know, just because they're not willing to shoot you dead doesn't mean they're not willing to stop you. Palestinians also clashed with IDF soldiers at the southern entrance to Nablus. 3 people were lightly injured, according to Palestinian sources. Similar protests erupt in Bethlehem and Jenin. A PA official in Ramallah said that the confrontations could lead to a state of chaos in the West Bank, holding Israel fully responsible for the escalation. The official warned that the PA could lose control over the situation if the Israeli aggression on the Gaza Strip continued. We've only got 3 minutes of our extra time, and in that time, I want to show you something really, 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 really cool that will really be of good use to you. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 3. I do believe that is where it is. Ah, perfect. You know, when we were studying Matthew 25 and the foolish virgins came and knocked on the door after it was closed to go into the wedding, and the Lord said, I don't know you. He said, I know you not. Remember that? After that, I was thinking, well, Lord, you know, I wonder if, you know, I think he was probably telling me rather than me, you know, asking him. I think he was cluing me in, showing me that a whole lot of people out there don't know whether God knows them or not. Okay, they're asking themselves, well, does God know me? Is he going to shut the door on me, or is he going to let me in? Well, here's your answer. You ready? Okay, here's your answer. In 1 Corinthians 8, 3, but if any man love God, the same is known of him. What a trip. There's our answer. God is saying that if you love him, he knows you. Isn't that cool? So if you know, if you love God, then he knows you. And he's not going to say, I know you not. He knows you if you love him. Isn't that the coolest thing? You know, I love you guys so much. I'm so thankful that you were willing to stick around with me some extra time. And, you know, when we have, I don't mind at all, you know, giving a longer broadcast as long as Cuban's okay with it and as long as you don't and as long as you're okay with it and you want to hear it. We still have just barely scratched the surface, and I don't know if I'll get a nutshell done tonight or not, but in the meantime, oh, there's a fly. I have to get my fly swatter out. In the meantime, God bless you. Hang in there, okay? Everything's going to be fine. These wars are not going to bust out in the next couple days. We still have some developments, remember, with Ethiopia and, you know, some of these other players down there. So we've got a little bit of time. Hang in there. Tell people about the King and what he's done for you in your life. Let your light shine, and we'll see you again tomorrow, should the Lord tarry, here, there, or in the air. God bless you. I love you. Bye.